Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my pathway. God bless you this evening. I'm Bishop Michael Rogers, senior pastor here at Kingdom Cathedral, welcoming you to another sharing of our weekly Bible study, Training for Reigning. It's my joy tonight to make another installment on our series of studies entitled Another Look. From now until the celebration of Christmas, the birth of our Lord, I will endeavor to share with you this mini-series in the series entitled Another Look at Christmas, or more aptly put, Another Look at the Birth of Christ. I invite your attention now to the Gospel record of Matthew, chapter 2. And our reading will commence at verse 1 and end at verse 12. I'm going to ask that you would entertain the reading of the Holy Scripture, and then afterwards we'll come back and teach the Word of God and exegete this passage. Here beginneth the reading of the Holy Scripture. Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him. When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel. Then Herod, when he had privily called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent to them to Bethlehem and said, Go and search diligently for the young child, and when ye have found him, bring me word again, that I may come and worship him also. When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star, which they saw in the east, went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their own country another way. And so far the scripture. I want to begin this evening sharing with something very interesting that I discovered while trying to prepare this lesson for you. It's a letter that is written to Santa. It points out vividly that a part of this world places more emphasis on receiving than giving, on tinsel than time with the family, on Santa rather than Jesus. And so I'm going to ask that you would listen closely to what this young mother writes to Santa. She writes, "Dear Santa Claus, you're probably surprised to receive this letter from an adult. You may be even more surprised as you read to find that the writer is neither a maiden aunt nor a disgruntled bachelor. I'm a young mother. It isn't my intention, Santa, to hurt your feelings. You see, my family has paid tribute to you for many past Christmases. My husband and I, when we were in our childhood, and now our children, who are 6, 4, and 1, they still care for you. How much they care has really been proved a problem in recent years. It is threatening to happen again this holiday season. Our children worship you. They speak of you constantly. They watch diligently for your December 25th appearance. Can you tell us, Santa, what have you done to deserve this faithfulness from 2 generations? Can you promise any future consideration in exchange for past loyalties? During a family crisis, have you ever told us, 'Lo, I am with you always'? Were you ever with us during sorrow to comfort us with these words, 'But your sorrow will be turned into joy'? And Santa, there have been doubtful times where we wondered, 'Where were you? We didn't hear from you,' or any calming message such as, 'I will never leave thee nor forsake thee.' We have come to the conclusion that if you have been even less than a friend should be, and we have been shortchanged. My 3 children have stood in a windy, cold main street just to get a glimpse of your jolly face. They have written heartfelt yearly letters. They have gone to department stores to whisper in your ear. They have worked hard at being good in anticipation of your Christmas Eve visit. Yes, they've done all this as their father and I did before them. But there's going to be a change this Christmas. There isn't going to be any Santa Claus worship in our home. We've decided to focus our attention and adoration on another being, one who has stood by us the other 364 days this past year, one who has comforted us during the sorrowful and doubtful times, and yes, the times of crises also. It's true that your name will probably be mentioned around our house, Santa. Old habits are hard to break abruptly, but someone else's name will be mentioned much more often. The children will probably work just as hard at being good, but I hope they will do it for another inducement, one that will last a whole year long, to bring glory to another's name. That other one has given us so much more, and not just on a whim, but on this December 25th and all throughout the coming year, we want a comforter, a healer, a strengthening king. We don't want a myth any longer. You see, our Christmas thoughts will revolve around a manger, a tiny babe wrapped in swaddling clothes. We've talked it over this year. We've decided to give tribute, honor, and worship to someone who really deserves them, to the true giver our God and Savior. And so to Santa we say, farewell. Signed, the young mother. Wow, how touching. I think we got to really take another look, because some of us are not children and not adolescents, not just adults, but have become even senior in our lives, and we still hold to these fictional characters, and we still get excited over this secular Christmas story. For just a few moments this evening, I want to attempt to view the first Christmas, or the experience of the first Christmas, through the eyes of those who were actually there, seeing it as they saw it, feeling it as they felt it. I want our perspective of Christmas to be, if you will, reshaped. That it's not just about an event that took place 2,000 years ago, but if we will allow Christ to be born anew in our hearts and in our spirits, we're going to discover something very powerful, and that is that it can be Christmas all year long. Let's go back now to Matthew's Gospel, chapter number 2. And let's see what's going on. The Bible says Jesus is now born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king. And Herod is found here in verse 2 saying, where is he that is born king of the Jews? Or should I say the magi or the wise men are saying, where is the king of the Jews? And where is he born? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him. Now here the Bible says in verse 3 that Herod the king had heard these things and listened to his response. He was troubled, concerned, and all Jerusalem with him. I need you to understand my very first point, that when confronted with the birth of Christ, some showed hatred and hostility. What a perspective. You wanted to know, again, where did you hear this? He was troubled by these things. The Bible says in verse 4, and when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes together, listen to this, of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. You know good and well that Herod did not have any good intention or goodwill towards this child. Let me also help you with this, and I'll prove it a little later. This is not the scene of a babe in a manger. By this time, and there's no particular record, but we could assume that the Lord is a little older than an infant, maybe a toddler, because he's not referred to as a babe, he's referred to as a child, all right? But the edict is already gone out by Herod that the firstborn of all Jews is to be killed, much like of the curse of those in Egypt. And so here they are, quarantine, in seclusion. Doesn't that sound familiar? Trying to preserve their lives. And Herod hears from these wise men that the Lord is born, and they're looking to see where he is because they saw a star in the east. And they want to worship him. And then Herod asks of the chief priest, supposedly spiritual men, scribes, when he should be born. Verse 5 says, "And they said unto him, In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet." They go on in verse 6 to say what the prophet prophesied. "And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah. For out of thee shall a governor come," or come a governor, "that shall rule my people." But you see, if you really take note, my second point, when confronted with the birth of Christ, these chief priests and scribes showed indifference. In the first case of Herod, you got hatred and hostility, but now, by these supposedly religious folk, there's indifference. Isn't it amazing that they did not themselves go to verify or to worship what the prophet spoke of? Because they were indifferent. They could care less. And I want you to understand, indifference is just like being against something.
I could care either way, Pastor.
Yeah, well, that means you're against it. Because you got to be passionate one way or the other. Jesus made a point one time and said, "Look, I have a better appreciation for you if you either hot or cold. But this lukewarm, come see, come saw, I can go either way, I could care less." He says, that's intolerable. "It's so sickening," he says, "until it makes me want to spew you out of the mouth." Notice this. Listen to the deception. Herod then goes to the wise men, verse 7 says, privately. He asks of them, or inquired of them diligently, "What time did you see this star?" What time did the star appear? The Bible says, "And he sent them," in verse 8, "to Bethlehem and said, Go and search diligently for the young child. And when ye have found him, bring me word again that I may come and worship him also." How deceptive. Oh, you got to be careful. Everybody doesn't come to worship to worship. The Bible says one day even Satan himself came among the sons of God. Isn't that something? Yeah. I want you to get this. He says, "I want to worship. Bring me word. If you found him, let me know so I can come and worship him also." No, the plan was to kill him. I want you to understand that it grieves me so that there is yet this spirit of religiosity. They couldn't tell Herod what he wanted to know. And it's amazing to me that this spirit goes on today of indifference and sort of a non-caring attitude. It's amazing. Many people, even today, they exchange cards and gifts. They decorate their homes. They go to Christmas parties. It's amazing. Some of them even sing songs and go to church for Christmas service. Wow. Without ever realizing the true meaning of Christmas. I'm not trying to be judgmental, but the fact of the matter is that most of the world has no clue what Christmas is all about. I remember a few years back, I don't even know why I even was watching this show, because it's not one of my favorites, but I happened upon a old episode of the Roseanne show. It was right around Christmas, and the show showed Roseanne talking to her mother, and the discussion was about whether God existed or not. The sister walks up, and after hearing the discussion, she says, "Oh, come on now. It's Christmas. Let's not talk about God." You see what's happening there? That I'd rather celebrate without an understanding of the reason for the celebration. It's amazing to me. That's how the world feels. They want to celebrate Christmas without the obligation to the reason for the celebration. It's amazing. We got to do something. The Bible says, and listen to this, in verse 8, and he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go search diligently for the young child, and when ye have found him, bring me word again, that I may come and worship him also." Verse 9, when they had heard the king, they departed. And lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. That blesses me because it says that if God is guiding you, he will continue to be your guide. But check it out. They saw the star continually until they got to where Herod was. The star no longer shone. And they were thinking, well, we don't know where to go because we don't see the star anymore. That's why they inquired, "Where is he, King of the Jews? We've come to worship him." But the Bible says as soon as they left out of Herod's presence, the star reappeared. I'm telling you that the guidance of God will always be present. But there's some things that won't be revealed to those who are enemies of God. It will only be once you have returned into his presence that you will get continued guidance. Notice this. The Bible says the star appeared until it stood over, check out the verbiage, where the young child, not the infant, okay? When they saw the star, the Bible says in verse 10, they rejoice with exceeding great joy. Praise the Lord. That's how it ought to be. When you get revelation, there ought to be joy. There ought to be a sense of understanding that God has appeared to me and has given me a sign that he's with me. Verse 11 brings us some powerful revelation. And when they were come into the house, let's stop there. Where did they come? Into a house. Now, we all know the account of his actual birth as an infant. There was no house. In fact, there was no room in the inn that they were. No one took them in, and they ended up in a stable where farm animals fed. Let me make it plain to you. This manger was not made of wood, as you've seen depicted in some of these scenes on some of these cards or even reenacted. It was a trough where animals fed. It was made out of clay, out of dirt. That's what he was laying in. He came meek and lowly, humble. Oh, my. But now, it's a bit later than then. It's still within that season, but it's a little later. He's no longer a babe. He's a child. And they're no longer in a manger. They're in a house. And when they were come into the house, they saw, verse 11, the young child with Mary, his mother. All right? Got to take another look. I know what you saw on the Christmas card. You got Mary, you got Joseph, the baby Jesus, a couple of cows, a couple of sheep. And then you got these three wise men off two different events, two different places. The card is messing up everybody's theology. No, Mary, Joseph, the babe, farm animals in a manger. Mary, the babe, in a house, three wise men. That's what we're dealing with tonight. That's why we got to take another look. The Bible says, and when they were come into the house, still at verse 11, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshiped him. That's the response. That's the proper response to Christmas. Or should I say more aptly, the birth of our Lord. Worship. This season should be full of worship, not shopping. Worship. Not anticipating what I'm going to get, but what can I give? Because worship is all about giving. Are you listening this evening? They fell down and worshiped him. How do you know they worship? Because I told you worship involves giving. And when they had opened their treasures that belonged to them, they presented unto him gifts. They gave of their treasure. Are you hearing me tonight? No, they didn't re-gift like some of you do, something that you don't want, so you give somebody something that you don't want. They gave of their treasure. They gave of that was precious and valuable to them. They opened their treasures. They presented unto him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. High value on these commodities. But they understood. Notice, when they inquired of Herod, they didn't ask, where is the baby? No, they asked, where is he? Notice the word. I'm going to go back to the beginning. They said unto him, where is he that is born King of the Jews? My. You got to understand who you're looking at here. You better take another look. This is not a babe. This is not just a child. This is the King. We come to worship him. And so the Bible says they gave those gifts, gold, frankincense, myrrh. They worshiped him. That's an act of submission. Would to God we would submit ourselves. Sub is the prefix. Mit, meaning to give. Sub, meaning under, to come under. That's what you want. You want to submit yourself. Humble yourself. Bow to the King. Praise the Lord. And when you do that, you have the King's covering. You have the King's protection. For the Bible says that they were warned of God. This is verse 12. In a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their own country another way. The Lord told them to take another route home. Sometimes the Lord will tell you to do something that might be a little inconvenient, maybe a little more costly, to take maybe a more uncomfortable route. But guess what? He's always looking out for us. And so they submitted to his will, just like we need to submit to his will. And here's the real test to our worship. That whether we have to indeed worship out of an uncomfortable place, it's going to be our willingness to worship that's going to count in the end. There's another piece that it just blows me away. I recall, and I made note of it here. Many of you remember, if you're my age or a little older, a great journalist and a great news commentator named Harry Reasoner. He wrote a piece about Christmas for the show called 60 Minutes. And in it, this is what he said. The basis for this tremendous burst of buying things and gift giving and parties and near hysteria is a quiet event that happened a long time ago. All the hustle and bustle and lights and carrying on and parties and festivities has nothing to do with all of that clamor. It's about a quiet event. There were no cameras at the birth of the Lord. There were no newspapers. Very much was said. In fact, most people, let's just put it like the Bible puts it. I'm not trying to be critical. He came to his own, and his own received him not. I'm not talking about when he became an adult, from birth until he died on the cross. And that was the ultimate rejection, his death on the cross. And even now, our present administration, all of these parties, folks not wearing masks, Lord help us. Just carrying on, lights and festivities, decking the halls with boughs of holly, fa-la-la-la-la. Y'all know what y'all sing. You know, I'll be home for Christmas, chestnuts roasting. Really? What, is Jesus in the mix anywhere? I'll be home for Christmas. And will Jesus be in your home for Christmas? That's the question that needs to be asked. Let me conclude. that we got to be careful that we don't fall into the trap of what I consider almost violently pagan practices. We got to come back to the central fact that on that day, a Savior was born. Thank you, Lord. See, there's only three ways you can look at this situation. Only three ways of accepting Christmas. One, you can look at it graciously. That's the appropriate attitude for non-believers who wish their fellow citizens all the joys their beliefs entitle them to. You know how they do. Then there's another way, and that's that cynical way, where one thinks it's a time to make money and or endorse the making of the same. And then lastly, which is, I believe, the best way, is to look and accept Christmas reverentially. Yeah. If indeed this is the anniversary of the appearance of the Lord of the universe, it's a very important day. It's a startling idea that a virgin was selected by God to bear his son is a way of showing his love and concern. This story has magnificent appeal. And so we're going to continue as we approach the day of celebration with this lesson. But I want all of us to start taking a closer look. God wanted to be close to us. God desired and initiates an intimate relationship with mankind. And the only way to do that, God has got to become a man. Because we couldn't become gods. God had to become us. And it was only through him becoming us that he could make us him. I pray that you've been blessed by the lesson tonight. And as we continue in the next couple of weeks to search the scriptures, my prayer is that we will really come away with the real reason for the season. Let's pray. Our God and Father, we thank you this evening for the joy of your first advent to earth. We rejoice in the fact that you and your divine plan was to draw near to us and to reconcile us unto yourself. I pray, God, that during this season, with all that's going on and all that has transpired, many depressed and others bewildered, some saddened and some hearts heavy, let this be, God, a defining moment where your love for us comes shining through. I believe in it, count it done in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you.
God bless you and thanks for viewing. Would you consider partnering with us with a financial contribution? We have three ways that you can give. Cash App, $KingdomCathedralVA, or you can go to our website, www.kingdomcathedral.org. And the third way, you can write us, Kingdom Cathedral, 3820 Stone Shore Road, Virginia Beach, Virginia, 23452.